This happens all the time. Okay.
If there's no cool animation, you can probably just go this way.
Okay, I'm going to do it this way. You can also see the history of the slides. That's very useful. So, lately we've seen a lot of interesting languages trying to sort of tame the wild thing that we know as concurrency. Particularly, we have seen Rust and Metsu, who is trying to do something with fine-grained control over the effects. So, our long-term goal would be to give semantic reasoning to these interesting programming languages. In this project, we have taken the sort of the first step, and we focus on a simpler type system, but we try to give a prove a more advanced property, which we know as automatic parallelization. So I will start by talking a bit about the language that we try to use and the type system, which is just a normal call by value. Lambda calculus with extended, of course, with concurrency and higher order state. And it's intended to sort of study effect-based program transformations. Then the language is on type, but we want to put a static type system on top of that, such that we can express free theorems in the logic to express optimizations, so that we get them for free, in a sense. And then finally, we'll talk about how we proved one interesting problem of the parallelization theorem by using a logic relation. So the type system, as I said, or the language is a lambda calculus, but we have extended it with the state, so we can read from locations, we can write to locations, and then we can also dynamically allocate locations. Also, we have a parallel composition, and we all have the compare and swap operation, which I think most of you know. We also then track effects in the types, so we track read, write, and allocation to the heap. And you can read the typing judgment below as in the environment gamma, E has the type tau with x epsilon, where the effects it's an over-approximation of the possible side effects E can have. We then want to abstract away from just looking at the concrete locations to have regions, and we will show why we want that later. So you can now read the typing judgments here as E is well-typed in the context where rho is a region, and X is a reference of type all in that region, so we have annotated the reference with rho, and E has the possible side effect of writing to any location in the region. So you can also picture regions as sort of cutting up the entire heap into blocks. We also want to talk about what's sort of private to one thread and what is public to anyone in the environment to order or to reason about parallelization. So we split the region context into two, the public part, noted by the big pi, which is really accessible for anyone to the environment, and the regions and the private ones are what we own, so they are inaccessible to the environment. So if we are to look at an example, here we have a counter, then what the counter does, it first allocates a new location and returns a function. And whenever one calls the function, one would read the location x, increment it by one, and store it back into x, and finally return the value by reading x again. This can be typed by the following effect type. For a region row, the counter immediately will have an effect, which is the allocation of the effect, and then it would return a value. And here return a function, and every time that function is applied, there will be effects running that function. So we call them latent effects, or we call them, they are called latent effects. And we can see that the latent effects here is a read on region row and a write on region row. And we have row annotated in the private part, so separating thing there is for public and private. Yes. So now an obvious question would be, how do we then introduce these regions? And they are used by using the masking rule. So we are free to instantiate or include a new region, which will appear in the private part, if row, the new one we introduce, is not in the free variables of gamma or tau. And that means, of course, we're not introduce one that is used before. But what is interesting about this typing rule is that we're also able to remove the region again whenever it goes out of scope. So if it's unobservable by the context, we are free to remove it again and thereby hide a lot of effects from the system. Oh, yes. So regions start out private, but they become public in the following way. So here we have the parallel composition between E1 and E2, and we have split the private locations up into three parts. Lambda 1, which corresponds to the first expression, lambda 2, which corresponds to the private part for the second expression, and then lambda 3, which is supposed to then be shared between those two. So through the parallel execution, both E1 and E2 can write to all locations in lambda 3. When the execution is done, we know that no one else knows about the locations in lambda 3 except us. So we can move it back to being private again. And this is what that typing rule says. So this was just sort of an introduction to the language that we study. In our paper, we have presented the results of a logic. We present a logical relation that has three key ideas or results. The first one is that we are able to validate effect-based program transformations directly in the logical relation. The second is that we support stronger data abstraction results by using this effect typing. And thirdly, we are able to support reasoning about trusted or ill-typed code. And I will show what we mean by each one of those. So the first question, to answer the first one, when is it safe to rewrite E1 or the sequential composition of E1 and E2 into the parallel composition of E1 and E2? It should come as no surprise to you that if E1 and E2 do not interfere with each other or the environment, then it's safe to do. This is expressed as a free theorem in lambda refcon. The following way, here we can see that all the allocation effects of expression 1 and all the write effects of expression 1 are contained in the local or the private locations for expression 1. And similar for expression 2, all the sort of observable effects are also contained in lambda 2. And if that is the case, then it's, the sequential composition of E1 and E2 is contextually equivalent to the parallel composition of E1 and E2. And at this point, it may be a good thing to say what we take as contextual equivalence. It's may equivalence, and we say, as it was also said before, if E1 and E2 are contextual equivalent, if there's no well-typed context, that can distinguish them. This was an open problem for 25 years, even though it looked harmless. And it was proven in 2012 by Lars Birkedal and more, and others. So, to show something about data abstraction, I'm going to show you another example. So here we already showed the other counter. Here we have a counter that uses compare and swap. What is interesting about this counter is that safe to run in a concurrent way. So first we allocate again, as we did before, but now we have a recursive function that will first try to read the location of X, then it will try to automatically compare and set X to a new value to the incremented value Y plus 1, and if it succeeds, then it returns Y plus 1 or else it will call itself recursively. So now we want to show that these two are contextually equivalent if we know that no one else knows about the counter, that is, that the region row is in private, right? Here it starts out in the public, but when we return a value, the value from the allocation of it, the row appears in the private context. So we are able to show that these two are in fact conceptual equivalent without looking, basically because we know that the region that they refer to is private. So this is a new result as far as we know. So the last thing is that we can reason about ill-typed or trusted code. And to give an example of that is that here we assign to what is a reference of Boolean type, assign one to it, which would be not allowed. But we are able to not adhere to the typing discipline because we know that the location of X is private. Right? We're the only one who knows about it. So it's sound for us in the meantime to temporarily destroy the invariant, the type invariant. Similarly, we can also type, leave out some effects if we know that the type or that the location is private. We think that it's crucial to show, these are sort of synthetic examples, but support for trusted codes is crucial if you want to reason about base libraries in Rust and so on. So these three things may not seem very hard in themselves. Why are these so difficult to prove? And one, reasoning about concurrency, it's really hard. Second, reasoning about higher order store, let me say again, higher order store is really difficult. And the thing is, when we combine these two, the current techniques that we have, scaling just means things get complicated. There's a lot of bookkeeping, there's a lot of things to keep around, it's not quite sure how to do it. So to show what we tried to, or the way that we sort of was able to prove some of these things is we want to show it by showing how we normally prove stuff with a logical relation. So to show that two things, that I will talk, let's say EI is on the implementation side and ES is on the specification side, EI logically approximate ES if we, in a configuration where HI, which is the heap for EI, and H, which is the heap for on the specification side, if they are logically related, if we take a step on the implementation side, we have to show that we can come up with that we can arrive at a configuration where the heap on the specification side is logically related to the heap on the implementation side. The reason why we have to show that for every step on the implementation side is because this is a concurrent language. So now the environment can interfere with it. And we want to rely on the environment also giving us related heaps. So we have to guarantee that we also provide related heaps. Right? There's a reliability guarantee reasoning going on here. Of course, the environment is compared to normal or to other logical relations, since we have these effects and regions, we can sort of constrain how the environment works much better than normally. Then, at the end, when the implementation side have reduced their value, we have to show in the end that we not only can arrive at a related value, but also still the heaps are related. So to show parallelization is why this is a problem using the normal way to do it, I'm going to simplify the problem a bit and say that E1 and E2 are completely disjoint, but we still want to show that the parallel composition of E1 and E2 is logically approximate the sequential composition. So we start out, as we did before, in a configuration where heaps are related, and take a step here in E1 on the left-hand side. Can we simulate that? Yes, we just take a step in E1 that's out by the reduction. So, and we know that we arrive at logic-related heap because we did the same step. And if we forget about the environment for a second, and say that we take another step now in E2, but E1 has not reduced to a value, then what we do down here? Well, we don't know, because the evaluation order says that we have to reduce E1 completely before starting to reduce E2. So the problem is we cannot match the reduction of E2 in a simulation before E1 has reduced to a value. So one thing that one can do is to continue executing both in parallel and record the steps that E2 makes, and then in some way do some catching up. That is what was normally or was used to prove it first in 2012. What we do instead is that we exploit that E1 and E2 is completely disjoint, and then use what we call independent simulations to do the same thing. So to give the picture of how that looks, is that we again start out in a configuration where we have related heaps, but now we sort of have divided E1 and E2 into what we sort of see as simulations. So we have lambda 1, or H1 corresponds to the heap belonging to E1 and corresponds to the regions lambda 1. And we can assemble the heaps H1 and H2 by just using framing. So if we take a step on the left side, we just take a step in the corresponding simulation for E1 down here. And to arrive at related heaps, we just do nothing for E2 and combine them. And now, what's the magic here, is that if we take a step in E2, we just do the same thing. We just run, but we run on the simulation for E2. So this of course, relies crucially on E1 and E2 being completely disjoint. But when we look at these two simulations, we actually argue as they are basically independent. So the logical relation we define in the paper is Schwartz's reasoning about multiple simulation. And when you say multiple, it's because you can have netted parallel compositions overlapping physical heaps, where we allow that there is a shared heap between the two. So to conclude, we are given a relational model of lambda reference that supports effect-based program transformations, effect-based data abstraction, and reasoning about trusted code. And also, as a meta result, this way of proving it, we feel is a bit more intuitive and relatively simple. And we also think that this way of giving a simulation argument is quite interesting. To relate to other work, I already said that the parallelization transformation was proven before in a logical relation that didn't have data abstraction by Birkedal and others. Also, to note other related work is Benton has made great efforts. Benton and others have made great research on these transformations. They, for example, have a system where they have effect-based program transformations, which we do, data abstraction, and also have abstract effects, and we don't have that. But their setting is a bit more simple in that they don't have the dynamic allocation or abstraction of the heaps, and they don't have a higher store. So in some way, it's a bit simpler, their system. All right? So thank you, and thank you, and apologize for the problems in the beginning.
All right. Thank you. So in the proof of parallelization, suppose that E1 is non-terminating, then I think the source can, in the source, E2 can be executed, but in the target, E2 cannot be executed. So how do you prove, can say about the situation?
So you said E1 was not
non-terminating.
So I think if I didn't say it, I wanted to say that the equivalence that we consider is May equivalent, so it's okay for E1 not to terminate, right?
I mean, if E1 is non-terminating, then in the source, E2 can do something, but in the target, E2 cannot do anything. So I think source in there is no refinement between the source and the target, I think.
So you are referring to this, right?
Yes.
So, if the left-hand side runs forever, it's okay for the right-hand side to run forever. So if you take a step in left-hand side, and an E1, okay. So you're talking about not the E1 as in, yes. So I don't see what the problem with the question was before, right? Because here,
So let's take it offline.
Yes.
So on the related work, there is a funny related work, which is by Jouvelot and Vouillon, that was submitted to Popple in 95 and rejected, and solved the problem that you had. They put the soundness and completeness of the logic using abstract interpretation of traces, including infinite ones, so you don't have the problem. So this is not my question. My question is about 15 years, you see, FX system were great things, everybody was going to do that, and 5 years later it stopped because it was kind of, the effect was exponentially growing with the size of programs. So how have you solved this problem?
So there's no automatically done in here. So to combat the first one, I'm not aware of that particular problem. So I don't know how to give a good answer to your second question.
Do your specifications for the procedures grow as you keep nesting them? Specify their effect. That's what I believe Pat meant. Yeah.
So I would go into the way that it's modeled. And the way that it's modeled by an interpretation of it into a separation logic. So we have resources. So we don't care about how the explosion goes on as long as it's finite. I mean, because the beauty of using the simulations, if I understand your question correct, is that it's framed. So we don't care about what all the other stuff that goes on. We only consider the thread. I mean, it's thread log reasoning. So we only consider what we are doing, and what else that is happening is sort of.
Andrew,
I'm curious about your notion of trusted code. So can that be in another language, like machine code? So you
yes.
just have some proof obligations for that.
So can you please read
the example you gave was kind of breaking the type abstraction,
yes.
but in the same term language. Can the untrusted code be, sorry, the trusted code be machine code or C or something?
And that would be beautiful if we would be able to do that. So not at this point.